very appropriate that we are following on the Singapore panel, which discussed greatly the issue of identity. And when we talk about Project India, obviously identity is a very important point here. Culture, loaded word, which we will explore. Custodianship and inheritance. Well, I'm also sure that both Krishna and Radha Mugali will address it in very different ways from the way in which I am going to address it, which of course is going to be through the artistic tradition of India, which is my very special field. We of course have, everybody in this audience is aware, this extraordinarily rich tapestry of culture that we have inherited. I mean, in the artistic medium, it's been talked about in very many different ways. You can talk about Aryan Dravidian, you can talk about Hindu, Sikh, Jain, Muslim, etc. You can talk about the Islamic past, the British past, the Portuguese past, you can talk about French and Dutch. It is a total multicultural mix. And all of this has contributed towards what I would call both the culture of India and the heritage that we have inherited. And so we are custodians of all of it. It is our responsibility to pass on all of this to future generations. We can't ignore things we don't like. Yes, we can criticize the British for certain things, but it's really not right, in my opinion, to take all the statues of Queen Victoria. I was in the Lucknow Museum basement recently, and there is this wonderful marble statue of Queen Victoria, together with carpenters sitting around. There are shavings of wood, there are piece of planks of wood resting against her and the pedestal. It's, to me, it just does not seem to be correct to do that. We can't treat the cultural heritage that has come down to us like sort of a loose leaf folder that you open up and you have the ability to take a page out and put it aside because currently you don't like it. Perhaps Radha Mugali will address it in the context of history, where it's even worse because we are replacing some of those pages, which perhaps is an even more sort of dangerous issue. So, and if we're going to sort of say British, and we don't like it, that's why we're, then should we not also do the same right out the window? So it is entirely a British invention brought to India. So that's one point. The other short point I'd like to make is, who is in charge, who should be the custodians of our heritage? Each one of us, of course. Who's taken over at the moment? The Ministry of Culture, the Archaeological Survey of India, and some more enlightened and better institutions, and of course all the museums of India. But it's for each one of us to take over as well. When you think of the Archaeological Survey, or you go to the sites of the Archaeological Survey, there's sort of a culture of no that has become part of everything in India. You go to a site and the site watchman comes up and it's always no. Why can't I take a photograph of something that is my cultural heritage? Why it belongs to me as much as to the authorities? Obviously, the authorities have to keep it safe, safeguarded, but not in the way in which it's going through. And our museums, of course, which are supposed to be our repositories, they are supposed to be the custodians in a way. The British use the term keepers, and I think that's the term we still use. We use the term curator, but it's not really curating, it's really keeping. And usually keeping it safe, hidden, away from public view, no access to anything in storage, no access to manuscripts. Even if you're a known scholar, there's a culture of no generally there. It's very distressing to see that. I understand that, and I will come back to this much later on after others have spoken. I understand that we need to safeguard it. And it is in the interest of safeguarding that these have been withdrawn, but they have been withdrawn in very unfortunate ways. Now I'm talking about the artistic heritage, and of course, in the cosmology of T.M. Krishnan's music, he himself is the custodian, personally, as a performing artist. And so I'd like to hand the mic to him and ask him to take over to talk about his take on culture, custodianship in heritage.
Thank you very much, and good morning. Well, I'm here as a, shall we say, as a practitioner of an art form, and from the world of arts where, for some reason, we are considered the representatives of culture in this country of some sort. It's like we're the cultural ambassadors, especially if you're a musician or a dancer, especially. Every festival around the world, you'll be one of us, and somehow India is showcased through our voices or our presence or our movements. You know, the first thing I was thinking of custodianship and ownership, and I thought of an analogy, and correct me if I'm wrong, there is this system in temples called the double lock system. I don't know how many of you have heard of it. For every temple, there's a double lock system. One of the keys is with the pujari, and the other key is with the administrative officer. And the lord, or the goddess, is locked in there by these two locks, by the pujari and by the administrative officer. So I like to use the two words of custodianship and ownership there. And look at the custodians and who owns it. And I think it's a very important analogy in terms of what we believe we are custodians of. And I think somewhere there's a problem in the way I look at myself as a custodian of an art form. And because I look at myself as that double lock system, where I'm limiting everything by the way I lock that sanctum sanctorum. So for me, custodianship, you know, while we use culture in this very multicultural sense, but who inherits what? I think that is a very, very important question we need to ask ourselves. Is inheritance actually something that is everybody's? Do I really share it? Do I actually feel a sense of sharing? I think that's more important. Emotionally, do I feel that I'm sharing all the legacy of Islamic culture in this country with me? Emotionally, am I? Because I think ultimately you have to feel something to really, you know, own it to some extent. So I really don't know whether, honestly, we all inherit the same thing. I think we've all inherited a microcosm of a world that we have created for ourselves. So therefore, when we talk about culture, I think we're all talking about actually parallel narratives of something we all have defined by ourselves. So whether there is this idea of Indian culture, if there is one, how does one address it is something I think that bothers me as a practitioner. Now let me look at my own world of Carnatic music. Yes, I have inherited it. But is the man who works for me, he drives me around town, his name is Kamaraj, has he inherited it? Is it part of his cultural inheritance, or is it my cultural inheritance? Secondly, how much have I locked it up that he never will inherit it in his lifetime? He will never actually inherit it. So this is for me, it's a point of conflict actually. It's a point of serious conflict. But this leads to the other question, you know, because once you have this problem, you think, okay, I have to break this. So how do I break this? I have to create cultural access. That's the word that you use. So which means I should make, at least the art form I'm involved in, accessible to everybody. But, you know, I used to do this with a lot of children and a lot of schools, and then I suddenly, there was another conflict there. So you go to, say, a village, and you say, Carnatic music or Indian classical music is an elitist form, elite in various ways, whether it is financially or by caste or whatever, but I need to share it with them. But there is a conflict there which I miss. Is by doing this, am I passing commentary on an art form that they practice every day of the year as part of their lives? Am I passing commentary on them saying, I need you to listen to this too? How do I provide access with respect? How do I provide inheritance of something that I have been a custodian of by also realizing that there is something that they've owned for all these years. Because the fact is, again, I'm a more powerful person than the person in the village. So for them to get access to my art is also a way of moving up the ladder. So how does one really provide access with respect, provide access with reciprocity? This is, I think it's very, very problematic. And I think we cannot discuss culture, in this country at least, without discussing religion and caste. I think these two subjects have to be spoken about, because can we really discuss the idea of culture without looking at a religious identity? Is it possible? Is it really possible for us? And I'm talking emotionally. I'm not talking in terms of data, in terms of history, in terms of what happened when. I'm just talking for myself emotionally. Can I talk about culture without connecting it with a religious point, with a point of caste? And if I have to, how do I negotiate that? How do I create a weave which actually blends the idea of religion, blends the idea of multiple identities in a sense that the final, shall we say, sari is such that you really don't look at every thread. You just look at it as one answer. These are just questions.
It's a great honor to me to share this panel with art here, music there, and here there is what? Note-taking. Prose, not even poetry. So, but it's a tremendous honor to me. When I was doing my Punjab history, published a year ago, I realized how from the time that Islam came to northern India, because Christianity had come to southern India before Islam had come to northern India, there was a great conflict among the elites between those who felt that the religion that was being brought, say Islam or Christianity, was a pure religion, and the local religion was an impure religion. Polytheistic, worshiping idols, so many gods and goddesses. So there was this notion of a pure religion. But there's also the notion from the locals, the elite locals, of the pure birth. We are pure born, and you guys, you are impure. You are the Mlechhas. So there was this tremendous conflict among the elites, which among the common people, to a large extent, this conflict was put to one side, and people coexisted. They became interdependent, trade in other ways, they got along, there was everybody had a state, is living, and so these great conflicts were put to one side. And in my understanding of history is that in India's long history, people have tried to reconcile or to live with these differences, not always find a harmonious middle ground, at least to be able to live with different aspects of different views. And Ashoka, of course, was a tremendous pioneer of this. But as we all know, when we're talking about safeguarding, protecting, what's the word? The second word in this? Custodians of things. Ashoka was wise enough. He had his edicts on rock, on pillars, in different languages, in different parts of the subcontinent. But very soon, all of India forgot all this. And as many of you may or may not know, it was only in the 19th century that the Ashoka pillars were understood. And for centuries before then, much of India lived in utter ignorance of what these pillars were and what they said. Take this Gandhi Memorial in Porbandar, it's known as Kirti Mandir. This is where the Gandhi family, for several generations, lived. And it is while Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi embraced poverty in South Africa, and although when he was growing up as a boy, his family were not particularly well off, but they had a lot of prestige because of their position in Kathiawar Saurashtra society, and this house is quite an impressive house. But and in the 1920s already, Gandhi was extremely well known, loved across India. But it took a white Afrikaner, South African, a man called Hoffmeyer, who was visiting India in the late 20s, and he said to people in Porbandar that, look, this is where Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi was born. What are you guys going to do to take custody of this place? And because of this white Afrikaner man visiting India, that Nanji Kalidas of Porbandar, businessman, raised the funds. Somehow all those people who were living in this house were persuaded to part with the house and became a memorial. So this too is worth knowing. One other anecdote I might mention here about myself. On my first visit to Europe in the mid-1950s, it was my first visit outside India, I saw these beautiful museums, amazing paintings, amazing historianship of centuries previous to this 20th century. And part of me was bowled over by the sheer beauty of what was preserved and the way it was preserved. But a part of me, the nationalistic, the anti-Western part, I was very full of ill will. I wish that some earthquake would destroy some of these. And then something happened to me. This is not the moment to give you the detailed story of what happened and how it happened. But somehow, and I was very fortunate that I overcame that silly notion. And then I had another epiphany. Not only was I able to appreciate all these places, in Europe I felt these things were mine too. So that also is my inheritance. These amazing things in India are my inheritance, but the amazing things in Europe too are my inheritance because the humanity is my family. So why shouldn't I feel as proud about Chinese treasures as I feel about Indian treasures? So this too is something I wanted to mention. I have some other ideas, but maybe I'll do the next round.
I would like to mention one sort of very troubling circumstance. I've been researching for the last 6 months in Tamil Nadu, and I've been looking at Chola bronzes. And I've come across a situation that troubles me deeply, and I don't know how to deal with it. And I'll just put it out there and see what your reaction is. There's been a huge hue and cry over smuggling of Chola bronzes. It's become one of those things. And overreacting to that smuggling, what the authorities have done is to take the bronzes from their temples and put them into what they call an icon center, which is a building without any windows, no air conditioning. They've dumped all these things in there. They're not labeled, they're not in display, they're lying against each other. The result of all of this is, as I went to temple after temple saying, where's your wonderful Kalyana Sundara, or where is your wonderful whatever bronze they had, they all lamented the fact that it's gone to the icon center. They've come and taken away all our bronzes. Now, why is this significant? Because the culture of South India, that Tamil country, depends on being able to take these bronzes in procession. Every Chola bronze is a processional bronze. There are festivals every single month. The community gets together. They cohes around the temple. The festival is partly sacred, but it is much more an opportunity for people to get together and celebrate. It's like carnival party. I mean, to this day in Chennai, you have Nagaraja has taken to the ocean. The annual festival is he takes a dip in the water, so does everybody else. And it's a community that gets together. So what has happened? By putting all these bronzes into an icon center, you've deprived the temple of its bronzes. They cannot do its regular set of 12 festivals, roughly 12 every temple has. Inscriptions tell us of 56 holidays at Chola time. Outlovers and people like me, of course, have no access to them anymore. Thirdly, You've also got bronze disease. Bronze disease which can eat into a bronze, and it is humidity that does it. You have it in the temple, you wash it, you lustrate it, you carry it in procession, it remains perfectly intact. You put it into this sort of conditions and the bronzes are gone. So what I am really concerned about is, one, that we will never have our Chola bronzes again as a heritage to pass on. I've seen bronzes from Egypt which are so eaten into because they haven't been taken care of that they're gone. We can't even see what the image is. So that's one. The second thing is that the culture of the people of the villages is completely gone. Yes, I admit people are moving from the villages to the towns, but this culture of festivals, which is so important there, is also in danger. And it is an overreaction, because how many Natarajas, yes, the Australian government just returned one to Narendra Modi from Australia, a Natarajah. So maybe there have been about 10 well-known cases and maybe about another 20 cases, that's 30. I would estimate that there are 3,000 bronze Chola Natarajas in the temple. These are the ones going into these centers, so long. So this is an issue that bothers me deeply, and I'm wondering what to do about it. But let me pass it on quickly to the other two.
I just have a couple of things. In this context, I can't but mention the news I heard yesterday, the day before, that there's going to be this huge statue for Shivaji out in Bombay, and the money has been granted. So we can't miss the intersection of politics and culture, I think. We can't miss that. We have to talk about, so whether it is Shivaji, whether it is Patel, whether it is Gandhi, we'll have to also look at how that appropriation is being done as we speak today. And finally, we have people taking bits of identities and finding their own, and there's going to be a piecemeal left. And it was almost, I found it very funny about the size of this statue and how it was about Maratha pride. And this whole idea that we are actually, you know, we keep talking about culture, our culture, but we are still talking about only little groups that we want the power. It's all a power game ultimately that's being played in the name of culture and identity. Even in Tamil Nadu, for example, the Dravida Munnetra Kazhagam, the DMK, will always talk about the poet, not Subramanya Bharati, but they'll talk about Sudhananda Bharati, because Subramanya Bharati was a Brahmin. So even there, when you hear the political leaders talking about poetry, and our ex-chief minister poet himself, there'll be a choice made on which poet is being presented depending on where they come from. So I think in this context it's important to look at that also in terms of how we are appropriating whatever we want. Depending on the politics of the day, the appropriation changes, the textbooks will change, and then we will rewrite them after two generations. So I have no clue what conversation we can have between generations after some time. That's funny. I'm so glad that you brought the idea of humanity into the discussion, because the idea of geography, that we talk about culture in terms of a geography. So now when you talk about Indian culture, we have this culture. Of course, there's this whole Bharatavarsha issue also, that we will extend it up to Burma and everywhere else, I think. But what is intriguing for me in the idea of humanity and culture is, how does one communicate, or how does one experience, first experience, I guess, rather than communicate, an identity of, shall we say, cultural humanity within ourselves? And importantly, how does one imbue society with that kind of a feeling? Because I think that's where we can really share, whether we are in Austria, whether we are in America, or whether we are in Australia, or whether we are in a little village in Tamil Nadu, in sense of a humanity, in terms of cultural identity, in that sense, is something that we need to, I think, search for ourselves. And we need to look at how do we transcend the limitations that we make for ourselves. And this is actually a question to you on how can we do it in terms of a social movement, in terms of a communication, in terms of reaching out to everybody, not to teach them, but to let them experience. Because I really feel only if one experiences will it really happen, not because you tell them or anybody else.
I will not attempt to answer that question. Another question that I was asking myself when I was reflecting on the theme of this panel, what is it about all that we want to preserve, to be custodians of? Of course, these wonderful the bronzes, or they could be monuments, and incredible music that we have. Supremely, supremely important, so precious, the sites, places of worship, forts, paintings, all our wonderful forms of music. But also perhaps there are some very precious ideas that we want to preserve. Notions, ideas. Now I mentioned this clash between purity of birth, purity of belief, but somehow India found a way of negotiating that clash. And we became a wonderful country of tolerance. Incredible space for all ideas. Certainly within Hinduism, you can believe in a million gods, one god, no god, makes no difference. Complete tolerance of all beliefs. Yes, Christianity will have a place, Islam will have a place, everything will have a place, atheism will have a place. Wonderful tolerance for beliefs, but of course, limited tolerance for people. You know, my people, my clan, my party here, yeah, they are the rest. Still, despite that contradiction, we somehow have maintained India. Indians are proud of our tolerance. And this, now this notion too is, I'm afraid, today under some kind of challenge or threat. Now when this remark was made the other day about Ramzada and Ramzada, children of Ram, one lot, and the illegitimate children, another lot. Why this preoccupation with blood and soil? Blood and soil. And once again, I come to the notion of humanity. India's notion is humanity, of course, and the wonderful phrases in Tamil and in other languages about that. So I am very keen that we somehow, all of us together, preserve that notion. That notion of tolerance and extend it not just to ideas but to people, and preserve the notion of tolerance of all ideas. If we can all of us be even imperfect, weak, inefficient custodians of this wonderful, precious idea, always let me say, Goa is a fabulous, fabulous example. So I think this is, I think Goa may, along with other places, really take the lead in an effort to preserve this idea.
I've been told it's a little under 10 minutes, and I would like to open it up to the audience.
Questions? excuse me. My question is related to what Krishna has been saying, that you are talking about experience. See, if I have a certain idea of what is in tune in the North Indian classical music, I may find the Kamakas to begin with very disturbing. Or if I have melody in my ear, I might find harmony to be disturbing. Until I make it my own, nobody can tell me. So how do you think this process, which requires concentration, time, exposure, and only then it will be valid? Like, same is true of a painting, where if B.N. Goswami opens a painting for you, or a great musician opens a composition for you, then you internalize it. Till then it is just an object, till then it is just a notation. So how do we, is it possible to start this process? And in how do we start?
I just wonder whether in order to have something as part of me, I need to agree with it. Do I need to agree or do I need to appreciate in this case?
Curious
No, if I may just, please, sorry. Because I think that we are not going to appreciate everything. We're not going to agree with different thoughts, ideas, musical systems, paintings, whatever, you know. But is it possible to transcend that baggage that we would all carry to a point where we can live with it? You know, if you don't mind me saying, I have a problem with the word tolerance a lot, with the way it's used, if you don't mind me saying this. Because I think tolerance as a word is almost has a hierarchy when I say it. When I say tolerance, I'm saying I'm better, but I'll put up with you. For some reason, that's how it always is used. Not that that's what it really means. So I think we have, I think what maybe we have to look at is how do I belong to the larger community or the larger or humanity without necessarily believing that I have to be appreciative of it or I have to be part of it in terms of appreciating, in terms of agreeing, in terms of being. But I think there's something you can transcend and go. Because, I mean, if you look at the geographical boundaries too, between South India, between Middle India and North India. I mean, it's, you take a train from Chennai to Delhi and you know that you are every 1 hour actually in a different cultural country, if I can use that term, you know. But yet, what is it that still is part of me there? So extending it to Europe or wherever. So for me, I'm not sure that I really need, in the case of music, a person who loves Hindustani music to come and say 5 years hence that I really appreciate this music. But I think what I would love is for a person who comes and says, that is also part of me, though I may not agree with it. I think that is the position that would really touch me. And I think that's what really matters, you know.
One last. Seems we are divided on the basis of religion, caste, regions, languages, landscape, geography. But at the same time, we aspire to be part of this common humanity. As Sri Aurobindo talks about human unity. So my question is, how do we transcend these narrow loyalties, still remain Indians and belonging to these different cultures, but aspire to a higher level of human unity?
I'm trying to kind of express, it's not a question, it's just a feeling I get. When you speak of culture in a country like India, which has apparently 600 million Indians who defecate outside, it's a horrible thing to be talking about at such a conference on culture. But for them, what is culture? I think culture and economics is another issue that we should be speaking about. Because I think the Indian culture will eventually be determined by the majority of people, those millions of people who don't really have the time to maybe read wonderful books, watch wonderful paintings, or be exposed to what we consider as beautiful culture, or travel, or see the wonderful things of other countries. I think for them, the everyday business of just living will change the culture of India. Do you have some kind of impact on how culture will develop?
I think the point you make is such an important one. It's also connected to the point you made earlier. I agree with Krishna totally that tolerance is a weak and in some ways condescending and unsatisfactory word. But if we as a nation, as a people, and true of other nations too, somehow can begin to put ourselves in other people's shoes, understand what they're thinking, we may not agree with them all, but at least put ourselves in as if those of us who are not required to go out into the public for our function, daily function, we have the good fortune. If more of us can spend more time putting ourselves in the lives of these people, I think that to me is also a part of culture. It's a part of being human. It's a part of being a sister and brother to my fellow humans. That is my longing for all of us.
Thank you all for being here.